meritorious. That's repetitive. Abusive and repetitive. Finding that, quote, defendants ceased accepting cable material from plaintiff in part because of it appeared to them that she had used the cable outlet to discuss pending personal lawsuits. Glendora writes, but this is not what the law says. Judge Broderick. The law says, a cable operator shall not exercise any editorial control over any public access channel. That's what it says, Judge Broderick. Whether you like it or not, that's what the law is. If you want to write laws, Judge Broderick, be a congressman. If you want to be a judge, Judge Broderick, enforce the law. Glendora already has appealed Judge Broderick's evil and prejudiced decision, defendant's lawyer right, and that, quote, use of the electronic media to apply pressure to opposing litigants can be abusive. Glendora writes, it was Cablevision, Dolan, Bell, Lustgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofold, Asnauer, Garger, and Quinn who were abusive. Defendant's lawyer right, Judge Broderick held that any state or federal strictures placed upon rejection of material by cable operators are not applicable to these defendants. Glendora versus Dolan, et cetera. Glendora writes, this is not what the law says, Judge Broderick. The law says a cable operator shall not exercise any editorial control over any public access channel. This is typically collagey. In every lawsuit, he talks about another lawsuit. In the Bryant lawsuit, he is talking about the Broderick lawsuit. In state court, he talks about federal court. In federal court, he talks about state court. It is a modus operandi of escape. Now, here's Kalaji's one footnote in his respondent's brief, which is nothing but a little memorandum anyhow. Plaintiff also appeals Judge Bryant's decision denying her motion for a default judgment. Plaintiff moved for a default judgment relying as proof of service on United States Postal Service receipts for certified mail. Bryant properly denied this motion, however, since defendants had not yet been served by a method recognized by the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. Glendora writes, this is another lie. The service was perfect by personal service and strict compliance with Rule 4, as Glendora has pointed out to the bench in her appellant's brief. Defendant's lawyer right, the instant appeal continues plaintiff's strategy of harassing litigation against these defendants. Glendora writes, this is a lie. To stand up for one's rights when one has been injured by liars, thieves, and cheats is not, quote, harassing litigation, unquote. Defendant's lawyer do not know the meaning of harass, quote, and abuse, quote, and repetitively, quote. Her complaint is baseless, defendant's lawyer right. Glendora writes, this statement of fact, so-called, is baseless. Defendant's lawyer right, and Judge Bryant's decision below dismissing the complaint for failure to state a cause of action was correct as a matter of law and of fact and should be confirmed or affirmed. Glendora writes, for all the reasons stated in her appellant's brief, Judge Bryant was wrong. As a matter of law, Judge Bryant's decision must be reversed, and Glendora must be awarded $31 million damages, and Cablevision, Dolan, Bell, Lustgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofold, Asnauer, Garger, and Quinn must return to her program to Channel 25 on Friday nights at 10 o'clock, and must, in addition, make good all the programs they have missed. These tortfeasors have denied the people of Nassau County valuable information about their public agencies, their courts, and their consumer protection. Cablevision, Dolan, Bell, Lustgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofold, Asnauer, Garger, and Quinn violated the law, which is a cable operator shall not exercise any editorial control over any public access channel. About defendant's lawyer's statement of facts, it is anything but a statement of facts. It is flimsy and limp. Cablevision should censor court TV because it is about personal disputes, because it is about personal litigation. What do you think court is about anyhow, Kalaji? This is how ludicrous Cablevision's argument is over their ridiculous and indefensible law breaking. The violation of the law is bad enough. The lying and the cover-up are just as bad. Ringing that you just heard, that was Martin Brownstein, who is the chief clerk of the Appellate Division, Second Department, Supreme Court of the United States, Supreme Court of the State of New York, Westchester County, and the whole Second Department. And he said that he talked to all the judges. That would be Judge Rosenblatt, Judge Miller, Judge Ritter, and Judge Santucci. And he told them about how I had to be at Judge Colabella's courtroom at 9:30. And so Martin said, do not worry about making the calendar call. That will be okay if you're not at the calendar call, which is at 10 o'clock. And they will put aside your case and they will cases, three oral arguments, they will put those aside, and then you can argue them later. And I said, I just don't think that, I think it looks good, because we talked to T.J. Mallon yesterday, and that's Judge Colabella's court clerk, and he said that Judge Colabella does those conferences, 1, 2, 3, anyhow. That means fast. Okay, we are resuming here. What is happening here? This is Glendora versus Cablevision, Dolan, and all those people, because they violated my freedom of speech by taking my cable TV program off the cable company in Nassau County, in Long Island. So I brought that lawsuit against them, and Judge Bryant ruled badly. And so I appealed that decision of Judge Bryant. And my appellant's brief has gone in long ago, and back came the respondent's brief, though it's the defendant's brief, or the appellee's brief. And now this is my reply brief to theirs, and this ends it. I have the last word. Yuck, yuck. Where were we? Glendora states, how come her program has been on cable TV for 20 years and has never been censored? And how come Cablevision has to come along and break four laws? How come Cablevision has to come along and defile Congress' intent for public access? This is to inform the public and to stimulate public access. Glendora asks also, how come her program is currently on 9 other cable companies? Also, and since 3 of these systems are Cablevision systems, it's Cablevision Yonkers, Cablevision Yorktown, and Cablevision Harrison, Port Chester, isn't the inconsistency blatantly obvious? Isn't the lying and cover-up at Cablevision heinous? Please take judicial notice. That's a good camera. Canon makes a good camera. And of course, they make wonderful lenses. This lawyer, Robert M. Kalaji, is not on your list as being admitted to practice before your courts, for your court. Point 16, counter to defendant's lawyer's point 1, Cablevision was acting under color of state when it censored plaintiff's television program, and therefore the complaint states a claim against Cablevision under Title 42, United States Code, Section 1983, and for violation of plaintiff's First Amendment rights. A, Cablevision of Long Island is franchised by local municipalities and operates under color of state law. B, Cablevision of Long Island is a monopoly and operates under color of state law. There are no other cable companies in the municipalities of Long Island that Cablevision serves or disserves. Cablevision, Dolan, Bell, Lusgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofalt, Osnauer, Garger, and Quinn were acting under color of state law when they censored Glendora's program. Defendant lawyers state, when they made the decision to continue cable casting Glendora's program, Glendora states, tell it as it is. Discontinue cable casting, quote unquote, is really censoring, quote unquote. That is breaking the law. That is breaking four laws. Therefore, plaintiff's complaint does present a cognizable claim under Title 42, the United States Code, Section 1983, based on deprivation of her First and 14th Amendment rights and for abridgment of her free speech rights, and these claims were improperly dismissed by the district court for want of governmental action. Point B, plaintiff Glendora's counterargument to defendant's lawyer, point 2, the district court improperly dismissed plaintiff's supplemental state law claims. A, Judge Bryant, although he did not like lawyer Robert Kalaji, did want Cablevision et al. To win. His ignoring Cablevision's breaking of Title 47, the United States Code, Section 531E, is just one piece of evidence of this predisposition for Cablevision to win. And here is 531E. A cable operator shall not exercise any editorial control over any public access channel. B, Judge Bryant could have ruled in Glendora's favor on the state claims and should have, and has gone on record as having done a bad thing. It is like a Judge Manton decision. Judge Bryant was 100% wrong in ignoring all of Glendora's causes of action and all of the injuries heaped upon her by lying, stealing, cheating, and law-breaking Cablevision, Dolan, Pell, Bell, Lusgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofalt, Osnauer, Garger, and Quinn. This is hardly what petitioning one's government for redress of grievances is all about. Defendant's lawyer writes, since diversity jurisdiction does not exist, that means that we're both citizens of the state of New York, just the way you and I are. That's diversity jurisdiction. It does not exist. The court, of federal court jurisdiction was based on the Section 1983 claim and alleged abridgment of her constitutional rights. The court's dismissal of these federal claims constituted the dismissal of all claims over which it had original jurisdiction. The court specifically stated that the rest of the claims that you're talking about, if they exist at all, have to be litigated in the New York State Supreme Court. Thus, the district court properly dismissed federal plaintiff's supplemental state law claims. And but Glendora states, then Glendora takes her causes of action to state court, and Kalarji argues they are preempted by federal court, and he argues they are unconstitutional, thus running back to federal court. As Glendora has said, the modus operandi, he has escaped from court to court. He sells his soul means nothing to him, his only allegiance is to the dollar sign. Thus, for reasons stated on the last three pages, Judge Bryan improperly dismissed Glendora's cause of action, which defendant's lawyer nesciently called state action. The fright, shock, emotional disturbance claim was a federal law. Kalarji did not know the law and bungled on this, and so did Judge Bryant. Remember, Judge Bryant made his decision before he heard Glendora's argument, oral argument. As many cases as Kalarji cites can be found against as pro. All it takes to cite cases is money to pay LexisNexis to spit them out of a computer. This lawyer, Kalarji, is using the wrong color for the appellate's brief. Blue is the appellant's color. That's my color. He should be using red. He doesn't know the rules. This appellee's brief should be struck from the record. Gray is the appellant's reply brief. See, this one's gray. It's kind of pretty. I don't like gray, really, particularly in my hair. You see, it's gray. It's kind of pretty, though. Plaintiff Glendora's conclusion. The district court's judgment dismissing plaintiff's complaint in its entirety was incorrect as a matter of law. As a matter of fact, Judge Bryant said, please read the minutes again in appellant's brief. Judge Bryant said that he did not question the facts, Glendora, as she presented them to him. So here you have defendant's lawyer lying again. There was no dispute about the facts. Cablevision, Dolan, Bell, Lustgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofalt, Osnara, Garger, and Quinn admitted they censored Glendora's program. Judge Bryant's decision must be reversed, and Glendora must be granted A, the following, $31 million damages, Cablevision return her programs to Channel 25, 10 o'clock p.m. every Friday night. Make good all the programs they have missed since November 12, 1993 in primetime on Channel 25. D, paid Glendora's costs in this action since it was filed December 6, 1993. Dated White Plains, New York, June 13, 1994. Yours in truth, Glendora. Glendora TV ads, box 416, White Plains, New York, 10602, 914-949-9495. Subscribed and sworn to before me this 13th day of June, 1994, Zenny Johnson. Now, plaintiff Glendora opposes defendant's lawyer supplementary appendix. The court already has several copies of defendant's notice to dismiss, save the trees, save the taxpayers the real estate taxes for storing all these papers, duplicate papers, right on both sides. Judges know everything has two sides. B, plaintiff Glendora has already posed Kalarji's affidavit. Please read it again on pages 136, 141 of the appellant's brief. And that is... Now we're up to another Kalarji lie. Glendora states that pursuant to Rule 26.1 of the Federal Rules of Appellate Procedure, defendant's lawyer lie about Cablevision Systems Corporation and Cablevision of Boston identifying all parent companies, subsidiaries, and affiliates. The annual report lists many more, folks. Exhibit Alpha 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And here they are, just piles of them. You know, he just says it's Cablevision Systems Corporation, Cablevision of Boston. But no, look at them all here. Look at them all here. All of these companies that are listed. We have V-Cable, we have Restricted Group, we have Cablevision of New York City, we have Rainbow Programming Holdings, we have Rainbow Advertising Sales Corporation, we have AR Cable Services. He never listed these. We have the U.S. Cable Television Group and the Cablevision of Boston. That's the one of the two he listed when there's about 12. We have Cablevision of Chicago. We have Cablevision of Newark. We have Cablevision of Cleveland. We have American Movie Classics. We have Rainbow Programming. We have MFF, Cablevision MFF, a wholly owned subsidiary of the company. We have Monmouth Cablevision Associates. So it's a good thing you read the annual report and catch these lies. You hear those men talking? They're running. They talk just as if they're walking. They're doctors. They come from White Plains Hospital, and they run up here on Greenridge Avenue every noon. And they carry on extended conversations all the time that they're running. I couldn't do anything but huff and puff. We have Framingham All Holdings, Cablevision of Framingham. We have Warburg Pincus Investors. So you see, it's another collagey Cablevision lie. On and on they go. Oh, also we have Toronto Dominion Investments in Canada. So, and then we have a financial statement here from AR Cable, which Collagi does not list as an affiliate or as a subsidiary, and that's it. That's the end of the brief. Now that has to be served on Collagi tomorrow, June the 16th, and then these 10 copies have to be served on June the 16th, the same day, along with the affidavit of service. And we called up Monica down there, who's a clerk, and we said, Glendora is coming down to see you because you want her to go over the Broderick appellant's brief. That Gannett is not a monopoly, and she's coming down there to you. Why don't you let her bring those to you Friday and hand them to you in person? No. They have to be mailed on June the 16th. They have to be mailed. Now, that's stupid, isn't it? You know, they'd get there faster by being hand-delivered personally than they ever would by mail. Remember this, folks? Standing behind every successful man is a proud wife and a flabbergasted mother-in-law. And Harry said that the political candidate, it is only fitting that the political candidate won in all of the outlying districts, because during the campaign, he was outlying in all of them. Is not very bright. She thinks that Gatorade is welfare for crocodiles. In the courts, you will find that clerks are very helpful and very polite and they're very pleasant. They're very personable, the clerks are. They stand between you and the judges. And so they're very, very helpful, and I've found them always helpful. I've found some that have made some terrible, costly mistakes that cost me. They don't pay, I do. And this is true in the village courts and Harrison, and it's true in the city courts, White Plains, and the Yonkers Court. And it's certainly true in the appellate term. Courts are very friendly and helpful. And that's the 9th and 10th Judicial District. And it's certainly true in the Appellate Division, the Supreme Court, and it's certainly true in the County Court. The County Court and the County Supreme Court. The clerks are very likable and very friendly and very helpful. Some of the clerks in the United States Court of Appeals are that way, friendly, helpful, and likable. And some of them are downright nasty and rude. I run into a few that way. Now I want to go on to something else, and that is the appellant's brief and appendix. Isn't it pretty? With the royal blue binding and the light blue cover, powder blue cover. And so this is all together. And you remember I told you last week, 249 pages, that I wanted to submit it to the clerks down there at the United States District Court, United States Court of Appeals in Foley Square, and have them go over it procedurally. And I had a big fight with all of these clerks down there who thought they could get away with being rude. And so I finally talked to the deputy clerk, Mr. Coffey, and he set this whole thing straight. And yes, they said I couldn't do this. The clerk said I couldn't do this when I knew fully well I could, and I've already have I did that on the Bryant brief. And so he said, yes, send it to Mr. Lange, George Lange III, who is the chief clerk down at the U.S. Court of Appeals. Send it to him, and we'll have somebody look it over procedurally. And they received it. Now, that's a big step right there. They received it in the United States Mail. And but Monica down there wants me to come down. She wants me to come down. And I am in no condition to get down there. I've got something scheduled every single day, all these deadlines to meet. You know, in June, at the last minute, because they're going to go loaf in July and August, judges do a lot of things, have a lot of conferences. And so I'm in no condition to get down there. But she's wonderful to offer to spend the time and go over it with me. Must be pretty bad, huh? And so I made an appointment to go down there on Friday, June the... what would that be? The 13th, 15th, 17th, June 17th, Friday. And so that's where that stands. I'm going to go down there. Now I have to tell you what else happened on Glendora versus Broder and Gannett and Curley and Watson and Sherlock and McCorkindale and Paulson. What else has happened on Glendora versus all these people? The New York State Court of Appeals, where I made a motion for leave to appeal from the New York State Court of Appeals, the bad decision of Santucci and Goldstein and Florio and O'Sullivan that Gannett did not commit libel. So I'm waiting for permission to appeal that to the New York State Court of Appeals. And that's really about all that happened on Broder Gannett this week. And what happened on Glendora versus the DHCR and Estevez and the William Street DHCR and Governor Cuomo and all those people, the DHCR being the Division of Housing and Community Renewal, and Judge Coppola's two bad decisions, one and two, that has all been taken down to the archives. That is going to sleep and snore for a year and a half, because that's how long the appellate division will be before they schedule an oral argument on that. How to make the boss laugh on Monday? How do you make the boss laugh on Monday? You tell him a joke on Friday. I had to go outdoors because I heard Ginny crying underneath the window. So I had to go out and comfort her, and she just loves it when you sit outdoors with her, and it's very nice out. Yesterday it was 90 degrees. I was sitting in the shade and not moving, so maybe that made a difference right now, today, thinking it was nice. But it's 690 degrees underneath this light, and that's just too much on a day like today. So Ginny is eating her peas. Oh, how she loves peas. And I want to show you, this is the check that came from Lydia Gallicano for $1,580. So there's five lawsuits, and this lawsuit is settled. The first one was settled with the small claims. And I want to show you how we're reviewing the Ruskin. No, the Nikolai. Yeah, this is the Nikolai case. Breach of warranty of habitability. This is tenant against landlord. And that's going to be argued tomorrow. And I have to keep reviewing that. And that's Ginny. Because tomorrow at 10 a.m. I have to be there to argue that one, to be followed by the illegal rent case. That's was Ruskin, and he made the wrong decision there. And so I have to be there to argue that, so I'm reviewing all that. Frankly, folks, I don't think the appellate division should carry three cases and put them on all at once for oral argument. It's just too much for a person to remember the three cases. So I am against that, and this is the third one, the Donovan case, which was the punitive damages for the Con Edison, the illegal Con Edison charges. That will have to be argued tomorrow in the appellate division when it comes to White Plains. And that'll be it. The appellate division won't be doing anything in July and August. They take July and August off. Folks, because yesterday was June 14th, Flag Day, I hope you remembered. It's out there flying for all of our veterans who gave everything they had. When you give your life, folks, you're giving everything you had. terrible thing. So, John said that his son is not so bright. He took a group of 19 friends to the movies because the sign outside said 18 and under not admitted. And he said his son saved up $45 for a Rangers game because he heard that tickets were $20 in advance and $25 at the door. And Mary asked the travel agent, how long does it take to fly to Rome? And the travel agent says, just a minute. And then Mary says, gee, that's not bad. The last time we went, it took 9 hours. Ginny, you heard, scratching her nails on a scratching post. Why doesn't she do it outdoors? She just came in from outdoors. But she's doing it on her scratching post, which is really part of a table lamp. I mean, a lamp table. Just saw the White Plains policeman give a parking ticket to one car that was parked out here illegally outside of 21 Greenridge Avenue. And there was another vehicle parked right behind it, but he didn't put a ticket on that one. And when the postman came along, I said, how come you didn't get a ticket? And the postman says, because he knows me. Now, that's terrible. That's terrible. Isn't your conscience worth more than that? Both of them, postman and the policeman, about not writing on the backside of the paper, and that's got to be changed because we have to save the trees and we have to save the real estate costs of storing these papers. And also writing double-spaced. You know, a judge ought to know that everything has two sides. And that's my complaint against Judge Wood's dippy decisions. You know, the fact that I've undergone something like 600 tortious acts in this Walsh case, and what to him is important is that I wrote on the back side of the page to save the trees. I'm trying to tell you what happened on Glendora versus Daniel Walsh, Roberta Walsh, and James Walsh. My electric light has not been restored down in the basement outside of my bin, outside of my locker. We had to string extension cords Sunday when we went down there to file and to get out files. It's nice to know that your file system works, though. It's a great satisfaction when you go down to a file that big and you find what you want in a few minutes. And then you put things... paper, the cross motion to Judge Colapella about Elizabeth Hubbard, Michelle Mayapath, Alan Beck, and modern courts took about 25 hours work, two people. I had to write it, and then Franklin typed it. And then it took a long, long time to have it copied, have the copies made. So then what happened next? Well, on the scheduled conference date, that Judge Colabella gave me, and he said, I personally guarantee that the defendants will be here for for June the 21st, the summer solstice, Tuesday. I was there, and I think as fast as this, if I read it to you. There were an awful lot of people in the courtroom, and what was bad about it was that civil was mixed in with criminal. There was a criminal case, a couple of criminal cases, mixed in with the civil cases. There were a lot of people there. We waited around for an hour. Judge Colabella was supposed to be there at 9:30. He never showed up until 10:30. I think it's rinky-dink that the civil cases should be mixed in with the criminal cases for the Westchester County Court and the Westchester Supreme Court. And Judge Colabella went through the civil calendar. He did not call Glendora, so Glendora stood up and asked for his attention. And Glendora says, you gave us your word that you would be, that you would give us this day and personally make sure that the defendants would be here for discovery. They had even taken my case off the calendar. And I said that, I said you had personally promised us that the defendants would be here and you'd given us this day of June the 21st. And then Judge Colabella said to me, well, I talked to my law clerk. You remember at the last Thursday one? He says, I'll talk to my law clerk and tell him that he should have told me and he should have told you. So, there it was. Glendora says, I feel I've been manipulated. And Colabella got angry and he said he had known Glendora. Says, we have known each other for a long time, he said. And that I would get treated like anybody else. And I said, that's too bad because I don't want anybody else treated as badly as I've been treated. I asked him if he had, you know, read any of my letters because I felt all of my letters to him had been blocked by his law clerk and his court clerk. And he said, well, I don't do anything ex parte. Well, I said, I figure what you just done here is pretty ex parte because I didn't know anything about it. It was about 11:30 a.m. and it looked to me as though he had flopped onto the side of his dependencies. That would be his law clerk and his court clerk. He depends upon them so much that he goes with anything that they say. They really lead the judges around by the noses. So I felt that he had lost his control, and I said, I just handed him in at that point the cross motion. I says, here's my cross motion, and here's the affidavit of service. And the court stenographer, he didn't take any notes. He didn't wake up until halfway through the proceeding. And I like that court stenographer too. He's the one I told you about. Told me all about so much about how they get the notes. And you remember that? His name's Steve Sacrapante. And another Steve, Steve Kellner, is Judge Colabella's criminal law clerk. And T.J. Mallon is Judge Colabella's court clerk, civil clerk, court clerk. And so I stayed and I watched the rest of the proceedings. It was a custody case, which is very sad. When parents can't resolve the differences, and then it all heaps down upon the poor child as to who would have custody of the child. And then the another cases too. And the criminal case was a youth, 18 years old, and he had been charged with beating another youth with a stick. There was a fight on the sidewalk, I guess, and then the both groups of youth were running away from that, and one of the youth tried to go over a garden fence, up onto a porch and over a garden fence, and when he did, his heel caught in the fence, and he was hanging upside down with his stomach up against the fence, and these other youths kept on beating him with a stick, according to the two witnesses. And so then I watched Judge Colabella talk this youth out of having a jury trial, which is a precious right, a long fought for right. And the youth was only 18 years old, and he just got talked out of his jury trial, that's all, and that it would be decided by Judge Colabella. I really took a dim view of that, and I stayed there until 12:45 p.m. watching the trial. I watched the opening statements, and I watched the examination and the cross-examination of these of a boy and a girl, or a man and a woman, who saw out the window this youth being beaten and called 911. I wrote up my objections, and it is called How Glendora was double-crossed by Judge Colabella and his clerks. To Judge Colabella, what good is your word when you tell us you will give us a day, June 21st, and we'll personally see that the defendants are in court, and then you go back on your word? What good is your word when you write us that there will be no more motions and let the defendants make a motion? What good is your word when you write us an order for the defendants to appear June 22nd and be ready to be for discovery, and nothing happens? What good is your word when it is no good on paper? It is no good when you speak it. You have been manipulated by the defendants. This case has gone on since November, and these defendants have been fleeing from discovery. Then they come up with a motion, and you help them to continue to flee. We have been manipulated. Defendants make the motion behind our backs ex parte and get our conference canceled. Defendants are told to appear June 16th. They do not show, and that's just fine with you. Behind our backs and ex parte, our June 22nd conference is canceled. Our June 21st conference is canceled. You have no say. You get the pay. The law clerks have the sway. You are led around by your clerks. I wrote you how grossly rude Steve Kellner was to me 2 months ago. Your clerks hide this from you. You don't know what is going on. T.J. Mallon is just as arrogant and rude and abrasive as Steve Kellner. But you are afraid to stand up to them because you are so dependent on them. It is appalling that clerks have so much sway over you. You say it, June 16th, that Power should have let you know, and he should have let you know. Well, what he said was that Power should have let the judge know, and he should have let us know. But comes Tuesday, you back down. Glendora really looked up to you, literally. You are 6'5". He's a handsome man. But now she will look down at your clay feet. You have lost a very strong supporter. We thought you were enlightened, honest, and fair, but you have sold all that. I sent you an application to give me permission to bring my camera into the courthouse, and you never answered. I object to one ex parte court clerk manipulation, and you double-cross me. Your denial of the right to discovery pursuant to CPLR Article 3100. I object to that. You give me 3 conference dates. Every one of them was a misfire. I object to that. You give me a date for discovery, and you reneged on that. You say no motions, then you let the defendants make a motion and say nothing to me. This is not fair, and it is not justice. This is not what Franklin and others offered their lives for 50 years and 15 days ago. That would be D-Day. Why are you so late to court? Here is a list of judges who have arrogant, petulant, abrasive, and abusive law clerks. Burroughs, Nicolai, Ruskin, Donovan, Fredman, Colabella. Law clerks are not paid to make the decisions, but judges are. I think you should recuse yourself. It is time for a change. You have lost my trust. Behind you is the sign, "In God We Trust." The trust is violated. The Bible in such a courtroom is a sacrilege. Glendora asked for discovery twice from these lying, stealing, cheating defendants. They never showed up either time. Is this what I paid my $245 for to get this case before you? The court stenographer did not make a record. I like Steve Sacripanti, but you all let me down. I had a good joke to tell you that I've been carrying around for a year, but yours is a humorless courtroom. What you read here will be read on TV. How can you decide a motion unless you know the truth? And how do you know the truth unless you have discovery? CPLR 3100 gives Glendora the right to discovery. The law is on Glendora's side. The clerks are not, because Glendora will not take their arrogance. Glendora Dowsett, you knew on June 16th, the day Glendora appeared before you, that she had 3 oral arguments that day before the appellate division on the second floor. She doubts that you knew, she asked, that you informed security on the first floor to permit her to bring in a videotape recorder, an audio tape recorder, for use at an EBT, examination before trial, of the modern court's defendants. She doubts that you saw the letter complaining about how rude and abusive T.J. Mallon was to her in the office behind the courtroom. Well, it wasn't T.J. Mallon, it was Steve Kellner. But believe me, T.J. Mallon's not much better. I don't know what's wrong with these law clerks. I think it's this whole thing. This is not in my protest, but I think it's the whole thing, that these judges are so dependent upon these law clerks and these court clerks that they will let these law clerks and these court clerks get away with anything. Therefore, the court clerks and the law clerks become so arrogant and swell-headed that they think they can boss around everybody. Not only are they going to boss around the judges, they're going to boss around everybody in the courthouse, and they're going to boss around the public or the litigants. It's outrageous, the personality twist that these law clerks and court clerks have. Now I accept from that a very great court clerk. That would be John Sulich, Judge Wood's court clerk. She doubts that you saw her letter explaining the mistaken identity. The person she thought was Mallon was in fact Kellner, and apologizing for the mistaken identity. She wonders if all these letters may have been blocked from you by your clerks. And I think they were. I have reason to believe that they were. The law breaking of Elizabeth Hubbard, Michelle Mayapath, and Alan Beck and Modern Courts, where does it stand? The return date on the motion to the Smiths for summary judgment, and my cross motion not to do so. and to pay me the $21,000. The return date on that is July the 15th, and by law, Judge Colabella has 2 months to decide this, if he decides it. It'll probably be decided by his arrogant law clerk, Powers. What is happening with Scott Lord from June the 16th to June the 23rd? This is the Supreme Court of the state of New York, the Appellate Division. And it says that Mangano, Altman, Hart, and Florio, motion by the appellant to enlarge the time to perfect an appeal from an order of the Supreme Court, Westchester County, dated October 21st, 1993. Upon the papers filed in support of the motion and the papers filed in opposition or relation thereto, it is ordered that the motion is granted, and it is further ordered that the appellant's time to perfect the appeal is enlarged until June 17, 1994. The record on appeal and the appellant's brief must be served and filed on or before that date. The respondent's brief must be served and filed on or before July 18, 1994. And the reply brief must be served and filed on or before July 29, 1994. Enter. Martin H. Brownstein, the clerk, June the 10th, 1994. Okay, they enlarged my time to file the brief. You understand that I did file the briefs and the records on June the 14th, the day of the Cablevision annual meeting. I went to Brooklyn personally and made sure it's done. It's a good thing, because the last day to file these was June the 17th, and I received this letter on June the 17th. Now, how would a person have managed that? It's a good thing that you have clerks to talk to down there who can tell you when things have to be done. Next item is Richard E. O'Connell, Chapter 7 trustee, having filed his final report in accounting and trustees. This is on the Scott Lord bankruptcy, Atlantis Lawn Sprinklers. For compensation, he's going to get a total of... Okay, this page doesn't have the total. Yeah, I guess it does. Take, add this up, please. $767 and $4,200. So that's $5,000 plus 186 disbursements signed by Judge Collins. So he's going to get much more money than I am, the trustee, signed by Marvin Holland. He's going to get $5,200. I'm going to get $3,200. He's making more than, he's making $2,000 more than I am. As far as ever getting that $3,200, nobody still knows. It hasn't come yet. And here this is June the 23rd, 1994, Thursday. I called today and Karen said, well, we're waiting for an order from the judge and we're waiting for an approval by the trustee. It's ridiculous. This bankruptcy started on January 30th, 1990, and it's 4.5 years later. And these poor creditors have not been reimbursed. And even then, they're not going to be in reverse for all of the money they lost. They're going to get 68 cents on the dollar. But that's good. But you don't see it coming in the mail, do you? As far as James Picken goes, he is still James Picken. He hasn't written to Glendora as County Supervisor Galata requested him to. So far as we know, Scott Lord is out there right under James Picken's nose, operating a business without a consumer affairs license. And I don't know what the reason of James Picken is for existing to let that go on. These are the minutes that I bought for $40.50 from Pat Florio. And isn't it funny? They wrote a joke every day. These are why the so minutes were so long getting to me. And they wrote a joke every day. Why did the chicken cross the road? Because he... Because it knew we needed joke material. That was their joke for Monday. And then their joke for Tuesday is, what do you call a woman with one leg? Eileen. What do you call a guy who hangs on the wall? Art. What do you call a guy, that was their Wednesday joke. Here's their Thursday joke. What do you call a guy who lies on the floor? Matt. That was and Friday joke. What do you call a guy with no arms and legs in the water? Bob. That's really cute, wasn't it, of them to do it. And now I'm going to read you the minutes. This foolish action that Scott Lord brought, that Glendora was violating the automatic stay, and Stuchen, of course, knew it was foolish, but he was getting paid, so what does he care? And so here are the minutes. And this is what they look like. They charge you $4.50. That page right there costs $4.50. Isn't that a terrible ripoff? Court reform. Something's got to be done about that. Also present, Glendora Franklin Buell, Mrs. Scott Lord, the court. Number 4, Atlantis Lawn Spring, Chris Stuchen. That's the lawyer for Scott Lord. Good morning, Your Honor. Glendora, good morning. The court, good morning. Will the parties please identify themselves? Stuchen, for the debtor, Bert Stuchen, 475 Front Street, Hempstead, New York. The court and this gentleman, Scott Lord, L-O-R-D, Scott Lord said, 3208 Ocean Harbor Drive, Oceanside. The court, ma'am. Glendora, I am Glendora, pro se, box 416, White Plains, New York. Mr. Buell, Franklin Buell, Glendora's husband, the court, will you very briefly give me your legal argument? He says to Stuchen. Stuchen, yes, Your Honor, the debtor in this case filed a Chapter 7 petition in January 25, 1990, a voluntary petition prior to that time, in or about October 31, 1986. Glendora Buell, the creditor, doing business at Glendora TV Ads, obtained a default judgment against the debtor. Since that time, M.S. Buell has engaged in a campaign of harassment in order to effectuate collection of the judgment, despite the fact that the debtor had filed for relief under Chapter 7 and was entitled to the protection of the automatic stay provisions. This is all a lie. This campaign of harassment included sending out monthly mailings to the court. I'm just not going to say the court, I'm going to say Judge Holler. Harassment per se is not a violation of anything. Stuchen, I'm getting into the various things that were done, Your Honor. She sent out 106. Holland, just a moment. Harassment per se is not sanctionable in this court. It may be in the state court, but it's not in this court. What section and subsection of 362 are you alleging that the respondent is subject to sanctions for violating? Stuchen, subsection 8. Holland, Judge Holland, no, sir. Subsection H is the section which gives you the right to damages in the appropriate cases, where one of the substantive or prohibitory subdivision of Section 362 has been violated. Which of the sections or subsections of 362 are you claiming to have been violated? That's not clear from your papers. Stuchen, may I look at the code, Your Honor? Judge, did you look at the code before you drew your papers? Stuchen, I am satisfied that the actions of the defendant as set forth in the petition show a violation of E. Judge Holland, excuse me, the petition was filed before the activity of the respondent? Stuchen, that is right. Holland, the petition is the document which commenced the case? Stuchen, yes, and put the automatic stay provisions in effect, Stuchen is saying, and that subsequent to that point is when the creditor in this matter commenced doing various things, including a cable casting series on Cablevision against my client, accusing him of being a liar or a thief or a fraud and sending monthly billings, mailings to. The court, just a moment. Who is your client? The debtor, Atlantis Lawn Sprinkler Company Incorporated, or the individual, being Scott Lord? Stuchen, both, Your Honor. Judge Holland, okay. Stuchen. These actions have been directed against the principal, Mr. Scott Lord in particular, but they have also involved the debtor corporation. Judge Holland, what is the status of the Atlantis Lawn Sprinkler Company Incorporated case? Stuchen, I believe on or about the 1st of April, there was monies distributed by the trustee to satisfy the judgment of the creditor of in this case and other outstanding matters that just happened very recently. So that, in fact, I believe the full distribution has been made to the creditor of all sums and she will be receiving. Haven't got a penny yet. Judge Holland, then for all practical purposes, the case is closed, is it not? Stuchen, yes, for all practical purposes it is, except that the campaign of libel and slander by the creditor continues and has continued for 4 years and is still continuing. Court, okay. Stuchen, in furtherance of the campaign to collect this judgment during the period that there was an automatic stay, Your Honor, the creditor distributed approximately 110 monthly mailings, which were sent to people that were not. Judge Holland, I am trying to get your legal argument. I read your papers and am familiar with the allegations. From whom do you claim the respondent was attempting to collect? Stuchen, she was attempting to collect from the debtor corporation. Judge Holland, how could she be attempting to collect from the debtor corporation when all of the assets of the debtor corporation were in the hands of the trustee, and the debtor corporation was no longer operating? Ms. Stutchen, she was attempting, Your Honor, to compel the principal of the corporation to personally pay that debt, notwithstanding that fact. Judge Holland, that is a different answer than you just gave me for the same question. Stutchen, well, the answer to your question, logically, it was impossible for the debtor to pay the judgment, and it would be illegal for the debtor to pay the judgment, and a preference for the debtor to do so. Judge Holland, the debtor could not have had what the debtor wanted to, because the debtor was a corporate debtor, and all of whose assets were in the possession of the trustee. Stutchen, that is correct. Holland, okay. Stutchen, that is correct. And notwithstanding that the creditor used various unlawful tactics to compel the principal to personally pay that corporate debt during the time when all of the actions to enforce the judgment were stayed. Judge Holland, the various subdivisions of Section 362A, which defines the scope and magnitude of the automatic stay, prohibits proceedings to collect from the debtor. How could this respondent possibly have done anything to collect against the debtor? And if she had, why is the trustee, who is in possession of all of the assets of the debtor, not here to be heard? Stutchen, the last part I cannot account for, Judge. Judge Holland, I can, because she wasn't attempting to collect from the debtor. She was attempting to collect from the debtor's principal. And I don't see anywhere in 362 that is covered by that prohibition and automatic stay. Stutchen, I am arguing for maybe the existing law in this case. Judge Holland, go to Congress. Go to Congress then. Stutchen, the court has seen fit to apply Section 362 in Chapter 11 cases when a creditor is harassing and unlawfully coercing the principal of the corporation in those situations, and in this case, a Chapter 17. Judge Holland, in a Chapter 11 situation, the debtor has possession and control of his own assets because in the normal course for a debtor to be a debtor in possession, having the powers and right of a trustee. This is not the case in Chapter 7. In a Chapter 7, assets of the debtor, of a corporate debtor, are turned over to a trustee. The principal of the debtor has no control over the property of the estate, which is in the hands of the trustee. Mr. Stutchen. That certainly is true, Judge, but why should Judge Holland? Are you alleging that the respondent threatened the principal of the debtor that unless he went and wrongfully appropriated the property of the estate from the trustee and that dire consequences would ensue? Mr. Stutchen, yes, in fact, dire consequences have ensued. Judge Holland, you are focusing on the dire consequences. I am focusing in on what the alleged coercion was intended to affect. Intended to affect an unlawful preference of the payment of this debt, Stutchen is saying. Whether my client, Mr. Lord, had to advance the money or borrowed it or obtained it from some other source and advance it through the debtor. Judge Holland, well, it's not a preference if it is paid by your individual client. It is only a preference if it is paid by the trustee out of property of the estate. Mr. Stutchen, that may be legally true, Judge, but if the creditor is stopped by 1362 from using any efforts to enforce collection of the judgment, it is my argument. The court, that would be Judge Holland. But your premise falls. Your premise is not an accurate premise. A person is affected by the estate is not totally prevented from seeking to have their claim paid. They are only prevented from having it paid by the debtor out of the property of the estate. And since the person, your individual client, who was the subject of what you call the harassment, was neither in control nor in possession of property of the estate, your argument falls. You don't fall under 362. Stutchen, if that is the court's position, I only think that it improper for a creditor to engage in a campaign to harass a principal of the debtor corporation into paying the corporate debts when those debts are included under the Chapter 7 petition. Judge Holland, if that may be, but not very But not every impropriety is resolved in this court. This court is a court of limited jurisdiction. It prohibits the estate, it protects the creditors of the estate, and it only protects them in those instances where specific redress is given by the code. Motion is denied, denied for the reason set forth on the record. So ordered, cross motion for sanctions is denied because I do not believe that your motion was brought in bad faith. Denied, so ordered. Thank you. Glendora. Excuse me, what, would you repeat that? Cross motion for sanctions because of what? Judge Holland, I do not think that the motion for sanctions was brought in bad faith. Glendora, thank you, Your Honor. Judge Holland, thank you. And there it is. Is that worth $40? I really don't think it is. So that's some court reform we have to do. It was a foolish thing for Scott Lord to do. First of all, Glendora was not violating the automatic stay. And it was just trumped up, and it was a lie, and it was obviously a lie, as it appeared in court. And Judge Holland really came down on Stutchen and really compacted him. But he didn't care. He got paid. He's a lawyer. And all of the things they said about harassment were a lie. Glendora had the constitutional right, freedom of speech, to report what happened, as it happened. And, of course, he can't stand having his record exposed. Scott Lord can't. And so that's why that came about. Colleges are getting very strict academically about the letters that they give out. They won't give an athlete his letter unless the athlete can tell you which letter it is. And did you hear about the football team that turned down their invitation to the Sugar Bowl because their quarterback had diabetes? And a football fan fell asleep in his chair watching Monday Night Football. And in the morning, his wife shook his shoulder and says, "Wake up, wake up. It's 20-7. And the football fan says, "Whose favor?" On with Scott Lord is, of course, the appeal of Gatel's bad decision. And I'm trying to write the statement of facts. And then will come the argument. And that's due on July the 5th. With a bang. On a Friday, June the 17th, I received the decision from the New York State Court of Appeals, and they have denied my request for leave to appeal to them the bad decision of the appellate division.
Thank you.
Glendora, and this is what happened on the 23rd of June, the beautiful month of June, 2 days after the summer solstice, and it would be a Thursday. The newspapers are saying that cable companies are beginning to drop C-SPAN. That's a terrible thing, because certainly this is a great service of cable TV. It seems to exist for the cable operators just to make money, but this is a great public need and a great public service to bring us the goings-on at Congress, the Senate, and the House of Representatives. So I'll just show you that headline. Some cable systems are cutting C-SPAN for other channels. This is nothing, of course, but cable operator greed. And here's another newspaper article to that same effect. Yeah, CBS annual report. Howard Stringer, who is the president of the CBS Broadcast Group, really gets poetic. If he wrote this at all, his name is assigned to it. He says that the veritable information superhighway, presenting a limitless number of choices to an already beleaguered audience, he's talking about you. Those maestros of the monopoly. Sometime I think that his poetry here is a little forced. The cable operators and their high priests of hardware promise the viewers moving finger, changing the dial, a positive plethora of programming in Aladdin's cave of interactive pleasure. But consider the following surprising observations. A noted psychologist, George A. Miller, conducted a series of famous experiments in the 1950s. In those experiments, he demonstrated that when we are confronted with a large number of options, we tend to reduce those options to the number that we can deal with effectively. So what he's getting at is that you have 72 channels before you, and you're going to reduce those choices of 74 to 3, NBC, ABC, and CBS, and probably to 1 to CBS. Technology should not be our master, Howard Stringer writes. It should be our servant. Here, let me show you his picture. He's the one who hurt his leg in Lillehammer and was limping around at the annual meeting. I told you about that. He says VCR has actually declined for every year it has been measured. And today, viewing pre-recorded material comprises about 5% of that family's local viewing. Think of television as a giant pyramid, at the base of which is broadcasting. That would be NBC, ABC, and CBS, then cable, and at the peak of the period, newer and newer technologies designed to capitalize on the lifetime of work at the pyramid's base. He's talking again about CBS. Now, in a bright new bottle, it's old wine, he says, our wine, in a bright new bottle. Furthermore, the captains of coaxial, that would be cable, have found a way to charge more for the bottle than for the vintage wine inside. Well, what do you think of this? Viewers would pick and pay for the 6, 7, or 8 channels they truly wanted and used, instead of leaving it up to the cable operators to make deals with each other. After all, why should CNN, MTV, or USA, with demonstrably small audiences compared to ours, be able to generate comparable profits? First, money would be allocated based on true marketplace demand for those channels people actually watch. And second, the survival of the programming base necessary to achieve critical mass would be guaranteed. Without that, in the artificial economics of today's monopolistic cable systems, original programming is in serious jeopardy as we dash down the road to dilution. All this poetry. Well, at least he's trying to show that broadcasters have some education and have some brains. We are very good in this society at being dazzled by the promise of the new and not very good at preserving the best of the old. Technology should be our master, it should not be our servant. It should be our servant. And of course, they're always talking about 60 Minutes. The CBS News is certainly consumer friendly. They had a good year as far as selling their programming products. CBS had a good year as far as selling their programming products overseas. There was a big demand for them. It brought in a lot of money to the shareholders. Criticism on television, particularly broadcast television, of violent crime. He says there are more reasons for violent crime than television: joblessness, alienation, broken homes, drug addiction, lack of education, and of course the availability of handguns. And then he goes into a discourse about what we should do is to teach one another to care about each other. That's certainly true. And I have said to you many times that the reason that we have all of this lawlessness, all of this law-breaking, you know, among neighbors, among corporations, in the courts, among lawyers, is that people have stopped going to church. They just don't go to church anymore, and they don't hear the Beatitudes every Sunday, and they don't hear the Ten Commandments, and they don't hear the Golden Rule. And I think there's a strong correlation between that. He says, I'm not preaching censorship. I believe the truism that censorship, like charity, begins at home, but unlike charity, should stay there. Bill Moyer said it well. What we need is a strategy of affirmation by society as a whole, from home, schools, churches, synagogues, and all the institutions that transmit values. Indeed, we do.
Jumbo Elliott.
The big guy.
That's his name, Jumbo
Elliott. Yeah,
that's
the big guy. Churches, synagogues, and all the institutions that transmit values. Indeed, we do. I think the best antidote, Bill Moyer says, to vulgarity and brutality is the power of a higher affection. Choices that enhance life instead of debase it. And of course, they beat around the bush and they don't say a higher devotion to God. And that's what it's all about. Shakespeare's Richard III unfolds in a sea of blood, but his victims. Hard paper to read from. Under 600 watts of light, it picks up the glare. But his victims feel, and his villains are doomed. Furthermore, the bard understands accountability and responsibility, compassion and sensibility. Well, good for you, Mr. Stringer. We should shed tears for them. That's another thing they say about television. There's so much violence that when anybody's hurt, nobody sheds any tears. We should shed tears for them. If we perceive the loss of life as unremarkable, that's a sad, sad thing. And that applies to me not only to human life, but to animal life and to plant life. Then the absence of love will also be unremarkable. Doctors tell of gunshot victims who, listen to this, folks, after watching our television screens seem surprised that their wounds actually hurt. And finally here, if we separate, like church and state, our artistic values from our personal values, then we broadcast programs to others we would not be willing to share with our own family and friends. Good for you, Howard Stern. We are guests in the living rooms of America. Please remember that. And CBS won't say it, and I'll say it to you as I've said many times. They are also guests of the airwaves. These airwaves do not belong to CBS. These airwaves belong to you, the public. And CBS goes and makes all the money in. And Tish, for instance, get paid something like over $10 million a year. That's how much the airwaves belong to the public. Well, they do belong to the public, and I have stood up for that in a lawsuit. So our personal values should be the most useful litmus test of taste and the surest guide to decency and sensitivity. That is not just preferable to censorship. In the end, it is likely to be more effective in a democratic society. And the last quote I want to read you, and as I say, it's very hard to read this glossy paper. You can see the glare that's on it from the 600-watt light. Network television will survive. Broadcasting is the social glue that bonds the national fabric. It gives us a common identity, and it highlights the common purpose. It is a mirror to the national soul that reflects our virtues as well as our vices. It is the medium that holds the nation together for the shared experience. You see, he's talking about what they say, broadcasting, you know, the CBS, NBC, and ABC. And as opposed to what they like to call cable casting, narrow casting. And so that's his fight for the mass medium. This is the annual report of 1993. Of course, the annual report of 1994 won't be here until 1995. Programs get videotaped, and on Thursday afternoon, they get edited. Some Cablevision. Cablevision of Harrison and Port Chester will cablecast from VHS. Now, that's good. I'll have to show you. Folks, all of these tapes that you see here are on the format 3/4 inch. Cassettes. For years, cable companies would accept only 3/4 inch. And those are the programs that are going to be edited today for A Chat with Glendora. You've got 1512 has to have a cleanup at the end for the closing, and the VHS archive of it has to be done also. 1513 has to be finished. It has about 10 minutes to go. 1514 will be a new program, the one that's being videotaped right now. 1515, 1516, 1517, and 1518. That refers to the 1,518th Chat with Glendora program. And then over here you see the VHS. Now the VHS format you're very familiar with. That's the home video format. And over here you see the 8mm. I'll give you a better look at those later. Well, here's the 8mm format, which is, I think, a great format. And I've been 42 years in television, and I spent maybe a third of my life changing from one format to the other on videotape. You know, at first the 2-inch videotape came in. And it's exactly what it was. The videotape was this wide, 2 inches. That was Ampex. And that was about around 1968. Now this is the 8mm. And this will hold 2 hours. That's terrific. It's a great format. And now, as I say, you're familiar with the VHS. These are what the archives go on. We have 4 programs on every archive. And then I'll show you this 3/4 inch that you're probably not familiar with. See, it's a cassette. In a case, and the videotape is 3/4 inches wide. You can't see the videotape because it's encased in this cassette. Now, in addition to that, folks, this is what we do for cable. And for broadcast, the commercials have to be on 1 inch reel-to-reel. Not cassette, 1 inch reel-to-reel. And so that's how it's gone. It's gone from 2 inches to 1 inch to 3/4 inches to 1/2 inch and to 8 millimeter. And I'm telling you, you go nuts going from one format to the other, and you spend 1/3 of your life doing it. I wish that these technologies could get themselves organized and standardized. There's really no need of that. But of course, the more you do it, the more they make money, the more tapes you have to buy. It takes 3 hours a week, well, an hour when you more when you count the traveling, to edit the program every week. And when you edit it, what you do is transfer from 8 millimeter to 3/4 using an edit controller, which is a computer that gives you an in point and an out point. And then you lay down the music in the background, and you put up the character generator, the graphics. A Chat with Glendora used to have beautiful openings and beautiful closings. The reason the closings were so beautiful that everybody was glad to see it come to an end, but they used to be very nice. They used to end with a sevenfold amen. There isn't any time to do that. Now they just end. They just start. There's no opening and there's no closing. So someday we hope to get back to doing a better job. What has done that is that there is so much law breaking, and there is so much standing up for right and bringing a record for the public to help the public protect themselves, that there's 5 programs a week, and 5 1/2 hour programs a week is a lot of programs. It used to be 1/2 hour a week, and you really could have time to do a nice job on it. But the thing now is to get it out and get it out as fast as can be. It's too bad that there's a month delay between the time something happens and the time it's cablecast. That would be good to find a solution to that. But who doesn't do VHS cablecasting is TCI. Maybe TKR, I haven't asked them. But Cross River does it. And here comes Ginny. Hi, Ginny. Over here, baby. And Manhattan Cable does it. And Cablevision Yorktown does it. Cablevision Yonkers does it. In fact, Cablevision Yonkers has sort of an automated cable casting thing. They have a technology there where a cable operator doesn't have to be present. Not a cable operator. A tape operator doesn't have to be present. So that's kind of nice. And who else does it? Cablevision Harrison, that's where I started this. Cablevision Yonkers, Cablevision Yorktown, Continental does, and Manhattan does, and Cross River. And I'll have to find out about TKR over in Rockland. Of a VHS, as you hand in 4 programs on one little VHS, and you saw how big the 3/4 inch are, 4 of those is this big. And it gets confusing. Yesterday, Franklin took the 4 tapes all the way down to Yonkers, and then he found out they should have been at TCI. So every week you have the distribution. You have to go to about 3 cable companies a week. Eventually, we hope this will all tame down as people learn that they have to live. If they can't live as God tells them to live, and if they can't live by the Golden Rule and the Beatitudes and the 10 Commandments, then maybe they can live as the law tells them to live. A response from the New York Cable Television Commission, that would be William Finneran and John Groh and Steve Shea. You can call there and call there and call there and leave messages, as I have maybe 25 messages to call. They don't return the calls. You can call there and ask them to come to the phone. They don't come to the phone. So, you know, this is a big case for them. Here is the defendant's Cablevision saying that their laws are unconstitutional. Here is Cablevision defendants saying that their laws are preempted by the federal laws, and they're not doing a thing about it. I think that's very, very clear. Now, what do you think the reasons are? Which of the above, we'll say? We'll do a multiple choice. A,
just plain ineptitude. B, out on the golf course. C, they're getting paid by Cablevision. What is it? Any of the above. What do you think it might be? This is air conditioning season starting up. Have you gone to a garage, a repair shop, and asked for a Freon? And are they telling you that it's going to be $110 and $150? This is the newest ripoff, okay? It used to, the Freon used to come in little cans, and you'd buy a can for about $5, and every spring, the Lincoln would take two cans, and that would be it, about 10 bucks, right? Okay, that's been outlawed, maybe with very good reason, because of the danger of it, and also because of the hole in the ionosphere, the environmental effect. We don't want to hurt our Earth. That's the only Earth we have. But now, then they went up to $40, okay? It cost $40 to do that. You know where it is this year? $110. So every week, or every day, I would go to Rick, who takes care of the Lincoln, and the man who put in the rebuilt engine of the 1980 Lincoln, and I say, will you just put Freon in? Oh, no, no, we got to discharge the system. We got to take air out. It costs $100. I said, I refuse to go for it. And I'd go back the next day, and we put Freon in. We put Freon in. I must have done this 10 or 12 days. His side of the argument is that a bottle, so to speak, one of those strong metal canisters of Freon has gone from like $12 up to $275. And then they make a big show of putting on all the gauges and all the pumps and all this thing. And then they always try to tell you that it's leaking, you know, and that you need a new one or that you need a new compressor or anything like that. But anyway, I kept going back and back and back and back. And finally the day, last Sunday, when we brought the Folsoms home from church, the engine temp sign came on. So I waited in the shade and tried to get it to cool down. I went down to church to walk Cinnamon the dog for the last time because the minister is going to Vermont for July and August. He's got a nice job, you know. He gets paid $62,000 a year and he gets 3 months a year off. It's a good job. And so I went and I walked the little golden retriever, Cinnamon, and I gave her her dog biscuits, and when I came out, the street was just flooded with my antifreeze. And so by pouring water in it and keeping it filled, we could keep the car operating, but it got to be too much. When we headed for Manhattan and 8 miles in Scarsdale, it was boiling over. So Franklin had to get down on the train to take the tapes to Manhattan on Monday. So when, and Rick said it was a new water pump, and that's a big, big item. Come here, baby. Come here, can you make it? Yeah, you can make it. See, she can't see. And she's lost balance because of her inner ear. Good girl. What a smart little girl cat Ginny is. Ginny's such a smart girl cat. And Ginny wants Glennie to stop everything and feed her, and Ginny's going to lie down on all of the notes so that this whole process has to stop. Cats always do that. They find exactly what you're working on, and then they sit on it until you feed them. So anyway, where I was, they said it was a water pump. That's an expensive item. That's about $100, and they charged $100 to put it in. And at that time, you know, I put my foot down about the Freon. And finally, they came to the census, and they put Freon in. Well, it was about $10, $20 worth of Freon, but I charged $60 for it. Thank Jude Florio for the jokes that he wrote on the minutes between Judge Holland and Bert Stuchen, Scott Lord, about that trivial and foolish action that Scott Lord brought in the bankruptcy court about violating the automatic stay. The automatic stay in bankruptcy is that when you file for bankruptcy, you automatically get a stay. Nobody can collect you from you anymore. Nobody can even talk to you about it. So that was a lie. It never happened. And then I keep calling Richard O'Connell's office, you know, to find out what are we waiting now for the check. What are we waiting for? And Maria says, I don't know. And Karen says, I don't know. Or Maria isn't there. And nobody knows what's going on. So I called the chief, United States trustee, down at Bowling Green. His name is Mr. Gonzalez. Give him credit, folks. He came to the phone himself. And I told him all of the difficulty that I was having, that nobody would tell me anything. I didn't know when the check was coming or if it was coming. And so he said he would call up and see what could be done. Pretty good. Give a cheer for Mr. Gonzalez. I've been trying to, Jeannie's fur is all over the place. I've been trying to get an appointment with Jeanine Pirro, our new district attorney. And so finally, while in the middle of talking to the United States Court of Appeals, Jeanine Pirro's secretary, Anna, called me. And so I said, let's have that appointment this week. And Anna said, just a second. Then she came back. And Anna says, well, Jeanine wants to know, what do you want to see her about? And Glendora says, well, let me tell you this. In 1989-1990, when Jeanine was running for county court judge, Jeanine could not see enough of Glendora. And wherever Glendora's camera was, there was Jeanine. And I say, and it was the same when Glendora was monitoring courts. So Anna says, okay, just a minute. And she came back, and we made an appointment for 2:30 Thursday today. But I want to shoot the breeze the way we used to, back when she was a county court judge and back when she was an assistant district attorney. It takes a long time, twice a week, on a chat with Glendora, all the bookkeeping. You have to index the tapes, the contents thereof. You have to label the tapes, the 3/4 inches. You have to label the VHSs, and you have to label the 8mm. This takes a long time. It takes 2.5 hours a week just to do that. And then you have to pack to edit. And there's one more thing you have. Oh, the distribution, you know, which tapes are going to go to which cable companies to play on which dates, when there's 9 different cable companies and 9 different programs a week. And that would be how many a month? About 35, 34. So that's a big job, too. Not that impressed with the New York State Cable TV Commission. I've called up there 25 times in Albany. They won't come to the phone. That's number one. Number two, they won't return calls. Now, who is this? This is William Finneran. This is John Groh and Steve Shea. Okay, why? Why are they not doing their job? This is a significant case when Cablevision defendants are claiming that their laws, the New York Executive Law, Article 28, Section 829.3, is unconstitutional. And Cablevision defendants are saying that their laws are preempted by federal law. Well, if this is true, the New York State Cable TV Commission has no reason for being. They have no raison d'etre. Okay. Now, why is this? Why do you think it is? Let's do a multiple choice. A, they're just generally incompetent. B, they're out on the golf course. C, they're getting paid by Cablevision. They're there exist to protect the public. So they're getting paid by Cablevision. And they're supposed to be making Cablevision obey the law. So it's a multiple choice. You can take one of three, or you can take all three. You see, every commission in the state of New York have to be like this. Do they all have to be part and parcel of the same thing that we found at the New York State Department of Housing and Community Renewal? Is it all that way? Is it rotten to the core throughout all of the agencies of the government of the state of New York? Calling the panel trustee's office, Richard O'Connell, all week long and not getting any answers and not being told what was going on. And then after finding out that the $19,500 in the creditor's bank account was drained, totally drained, I called Richard O'Connell. Of course, I called him every day, 3 or 4 times a day. And so at 9:19 a.m. Saturday morning, June the 25th, I called him and he answered. And this conversation is on audio tape 538-1. He answered, and instead of being rude, as he has been so many times in the past, he actually went at this matter. And comes to find out, folks, well, first of all, you said I had no right to know that the money had been taken out of the creditor's bank account. Well, he's wrong about that. As a creditor, I certainly have a right to know that. And he had taken the money out of the creditor's bank account, hooray, to put it into his checking account, hooray, so that he could write the checks for the creditors, hooray. Well, he started with how many hours he'd put into this case and how he'd cut his fee down from $14,000 to $5,000. And I think that's wonderful. Thank you, Richard O'Connell, for doing that. But I say, on a bankruptcy where there's $19,500 to be distributed, how would it look for $14,000 of that to go to the panel trustee? He started to negotiate with me on the fact that he wasn't going to give me my check. And he wasn't going to give me my check. He says, I want to close this case. But he says, you have injured me with this lawsuit, and I'm not going to give you this check until you drop the appeal. Don't you remember that you made an agreement with me that if you got the check, you would drop the lawsuit? I said that I didn't ever make any such agreement as that, that we had discussed it, and then we discussed it under a time frame that the check was going to come in April 1st, and here it is, June the 25th. May, June, July. What's that, 2-3 months later? And he said, you damaged me because when this lawsuit was filed against me, immediately my malpractice insurance went up $750. Well, I really think that's an awful thing that that happened. But then he was the cause of the lawsuit with his negligences. He just doesn't seem to realize that. He says, I am a good trustee. And then he went back to the final hearing of creditors where I stood before Judge Holland, and I said that I'd been chasing Scott Lord for 8 3/4 years, the last 4.5 years with his bankruptcy. I said for 4 years with Judge Hall that nothing happened and it took so long. And Richard O'Connell said how angry he was that I had said that to Judge Holland. He says Judge Holland didn't want to hear that, and I said it doesn't matter to me whether Judge Holland wanted to hear it or not. I wanted to say it. And but I said, I do apologize to you, Richard. I really misspoke. I shouldn't have said that nothing happened for 4 years. I should have said that a lot happened, but it took far too long for it to happen. That's what I should have said. So I'm sorry, Richard O'Connell, that I misspoke that way. Richard O'Connell says, I would like to pay myself. He's getting more than I am. He's getting $5,200. I'm getting $3,300. He says, when I get the assurance from you that you're going to drop that appeal, he's talking about the Fredman appeal before the appellate division. He says, when you drop that appeal, he says, I won't require anything, and he's negotiating now that he won't require anything from me in writing. He says, I can just say it to him orally. He says, the checks are sitting in front of me. Well, good. And I said to him, Richard, my getting that check from the bankruptcy estate on the condition that I drop the appeal, don't you think that's blackmail? Don't you think that's coercion? Don't you think that's extortion? And he did seem to back away from that. And I said, how come Shrewsbury never notified you that I had filed? Perfected my appeal, that I'd filed the briefs and that I'd filed the records on appeal, and that she had, and that I missed it by one day because of UPS and because of Copy, the printer. I said, how come she never told you that? She's your lawyer. He's a lawyer with a lawyer. That's the way it goes on, ad infinitum. And he said, I don't want to get into that. So he never answered that. And he says, I want to ask you a question. He says, why should I be responsible for so much of my life to you? That's a good question. When you get the check, are you going to continue with the appeal? And so he's now into that. He's getting down to saying, before he really got on to that point, he said, about dropping the appeal, I said, I really have a hard time for that. It's a fight for right. It's a matter of conscience. These were wrongs, and these people should never get away with these wrongs. They should be accountable. They have to account for them. And I told him again how Franklin fought in D-Day, and I said, it's not that kind of America that these men died and gave their lives to. And Richard O'Connell, at that point, said that, oh, said something about the $3,200 was sitting around. He says, no, it's more than $3,200. It's $3,304.88 to be sent to this creditor. He says, you think that you should say that Richard O'Connell is a single practitioner and he has four children, and you've said he's a poor excuse for being a human being because this took too long, and that's not what Franklin fought for, and that he's recalcitrant. Oh no, wait a second. And then he made this statement about Scott Lord. He said, when you have such a recalcitrant, slimy guy like Scott Lord, and that's exactly right. I have agreed with that for a long time. And he told about his father was in World War II. He had volunteered even though he was 38 years old. He was too old. They said they wouldn't send him overseas because he was too old. And then he went on, I said, was your father in the Army Corps of Engineers? Yes, he was. And he was out in Minnesota and he almost got a Purple Heart for that, but he refused it because he was injured out there. Hurt in Wisconsin, excuse me. So I said to Richard O'Connell, supposing I said I would stop the appeal or disenjoin or discontinue you in the action and carry on with Scott Lord, Jan Stahl, and Jeffrey Barnes, he said the check would go out Monday morning. He says, I need to have you tell me, and I will believe you, that you will terminate the lawsuit. And you may feel I was late. You told me once that I did a good job. He did. He did a great job. He was the only person I ever knew to collect money from Scott Lord. And number two, you got 68 cents on a dollar. And for a bankruptcy, that's very good. As bad as the bankruptcy is, most people only get 10 cents. But if you get 68 cents, that's considered good.